and darkness tries to hide and trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all will see how great is our God.
At Living Water, we seek to follow Jesus by loving God and loving others. What I think that means for Living Water is starting with relationships. We're really big on being connected, having that family kind of feel, understanding that family enters into messy situations, understanding that it's not always easy. And through that relationship, we're able to present the gospel of Jesus Christ, knowing that He is a Lord and that He is a Savior, and that we have a desperate need for that Lord and Savior. And what that leads to then is transformation in lives, becoming a new creation through the power of the Holy Spirit.
What does it mean to follow Jesus by loving God and loving others? It means, to me, that we live out the words of Matthew 28, which is to go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and then teach them to obey everything He has commanded us. And that's basically a large way of saying we go out to get to know our brothers and sisters throughout the community.
One of the things we do in children's ministry is try to identify who God is. And we talk about that He's very loving, and kids get that a lot. But I think one of the things we forget is that God is holy. But we can't just know that God is holy because we'd be scared to death of Him. We have to also know that He is loving, because without knowing that God is loving and holy, we don't have a complete picture of Him. So those are two simple ways that we try to teach the kids to follow God.
Here at Living Water, we seek to follow Jesus by loving God and loving others. What that means to me is opportunity. Opportunity to bring people together, no matter what path they've taken, where they're at in life, their flaws. That's part of the draw that brought me to this church, is it brings people together, it gives you the opportunity to grow, and you feel at home. You have a sense of family, you have a church family, you have a relationship with God, and people don't judge you for that. Our goal here at Living Water is to continue to let people in, to bring people here, to give them the opportunity to not only grow with God, but to also grow with their family.
For me, following Jesus and loving God and loving others means being a blessing to others. And so I've gone to church my whole life, but it wasn't until I came to Living Water that I felt like I could really use my gifts in a way that really glorified God, whether that be playing guitar on stage or singing or playing drums or in different leadership roles that I've held. I really felt like this is the place where I can use those gifts in a meaningful way that glorifies God.
At Living Water, we seek to follow Jesus by loving God and loving others.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and Lord Jesus Christ.
Brothers and sisters in Christ. How about we go blue?
Brothers and sisters in Christ, grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Good morning. This is Pastor Gary, one of the pastors here at Living Water Community Church, and we are very excited to have a few people in our worship center, and we are very excited to have you join us on YouTube as well. With all of that being said, at Living Water, we seek to follow Jesus by loving God and loving others. And we seek to do that today to give him honor, to give him glory, to give him praise. One of the things we're going to talk about is the first couple of chapters of the book of Acts. And in that book, we see the early church get started. We see them be excited about something, but we also see them miss the point a little bit. And we don't want to do that today. We don't want to miss the point. There is so many things going on, and there are so many details that we have to make sure that this service is working. But in all of that, we don't want to miss the point. And the point is that Jesus Christ loves you so incredibly much that he died on the cross to save you from your sins. That whoever believes in him will not perish, but will have eternal life. And because of that, we have a reason to sing. Because of that, we have a reason to praise. Because of that, we have hope for a new life. Understanding that we need the Holy Spirit to get that inside of us. We need the Holy Spirit to give us that message time and time again, to remind us of that message time and time again. Would you join me in a time of prayer this morning? Let's pray. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, you alone are God. You alone are good. God, we see glimpses of you in so many different ways. We see glimpses of being able to know what it's like to fellowship, of being able to know what it's like to have you so incredibly close to us that we can't tell where we end and where you begin. And God, that's what we want to experience today. We want to know that you are here. We want to know that you are strong. We want to know that you are good. And so we pray a huge blanket blessing over this meeting, over our physical gatherings of the Orange City campus, of the Sheldon campus. We pray that we would be protected. We pray that we would be guided. We pray that we would experience your Holy Spirit. And we pray the same thing for our virtual campus at this moment, for those streaming on YouTube. Either campus, whether it's Sheldon or Orange City, whether you're streaming one or the other, God, we pray that wherever we are scattered, we would know you more. We would know that we're tied together through the power of the Holy Spirit. We would know that as a church body, we are one in Jesus Christ. We proclaim your name. We ask that there would be a huge blessing, that the streaming would go well, that the sound would go well, that everything here would go well. God, we just pray that you would bless this time. As we were praying before the service with the worship team, God, you heard us. We're weak, but you are strong. And that's what we confess to you. We confess that we cannot do this on our own. We confess that we cannot get through this week on our own. We stand in need of you. And so bless us, please. In your holy, holy, holy name we pray. Amen. Let's stand together no matter where you are, and let's praise the name of Jesus Christ.
Let's sing of the Lord's faithfulness today.
And Father of kindness, you have poured out grace. Brought me out of darkness, you have filled me with peace. Giver of mercy, you're my help in time of need. Lord, I can't help but sing. Faithful and beautiful Savior, you have brought me near. You pulled me from the ashes, you have broken every curse. Blessed Redeemer, you have set this captive free. Lord, I can't help but sing.
From online or here in person, you keep your promises. You bring your people back together. Thank you, Lord. Amen. So guys, obviously you're not going to go run and talk to each other here in this room, but just, you know, shout across the room, give somebody a good morning, hello, Jesus loves you. And for those of you online, leave a comment, shoot somebody a text or anything like that. Just greet them in the name of the Lord.
And as they're shouting here in the worship center, hopefully you're shouting at home as well. We can hear some of them, I think, right? All the way from online. And I want to remind you, especially for those watching online, we do have a Little Treasures video available. And that is at Sue's, our children director's email. You will need to email her for that. We're continuing to work on how to stay safe and how to keep those videos as accessible as possible. Yeah, the TV needs to come right where this orange one is. So while you're getting set up, we will also get set up. I'll ask that you grab onto your scripture and that you look at Acts chapter 1. How do we look, Matt? We good? All right. Everybody can see online and in the building. We're all good. All right. Should I have a few notes probably?
Nah, just let it fly. Just wing it.
So make sure you email onesusandykstra@gmail.com for the Little Treasures video, and she will get that sent to you. That gives 3, 4, and 5-year-olds something to pay attention to as we spend our time looking at Acts chapter 1. And I'm really excited about this passage in particular, about the next 2 weeks, because we just finished up our Peter series, if you remember that. And one of the things that Jesse and I talked about is we obviously have to pay attention to the church calendar, to what is happening in the universal church, meaning that we're talking about Pentecost next week. Pentecost being the time where the Holy Spirit came down upon the disciples and the early church was really born. But even before Pentecost, I thought it was very appropriate to set the stage for Pentecost, to be thinking about why Pentecost was such a big deal, about why that was the beginning of the early church. And so what I wanted to do this week was title the worship service, title the message especially, Getting Ready for Pentecost. And how do we get ready for something? Hopefully, we take this Pentecost thing seriously enough that it's not just a flick of the wrist, it's not just something on a whim, it's not just something that we don't pay attention to. Instead, it's something that we acknowledge as a very important thing in the church calendar, that is something important in our own hearts. And so in order to do that, looking at the beginning of the beginning, looking at the stage that was set so that the early church could start, I want to look at the first chapter of Acts chapter 1. And if you were able to, you read through it, you saw some of the details of that chapter, and we're just going to highlight a few of the several verses. And I want to begin, of course, with prayer and ask that the Holy Spirit would bless us as we look at this scripture. So would you pray with me? Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, you're here. Your scripture is alive. You're speaking to us in this very moment. You're tapping someone on the shoulder. You're gathered in so many living rooms, in so many different places. You're gathered through the power of a cell phone screen, through the power of being in the same building. You're gathered through all of this. Father, I pray that we would acknowledge that presence in our hearts. I pray that each one of us would approach this message, approach this time of worship as a holy place. No matter where we are standing on holy ground, God, because you are here. I pray that that's not it, that it's not just an acknowledgement that, yep, this is holy, and then we move on. God, may we be changed by you. May we be comforted by you. May we be challenged by you. Whatever it is that you have to speak through this scripture especially, may it come through very, very clearly by the power of the Holy Spirit. God, my words are just a human's words, but if we can hear you speak through this scripture, if we can hear you speak through these words, if we can hear you through the songs and through the prayers, then incredible things are going to happen. And so, God, I pray that this would be a miracle in this moment, that we would have a direct line of communication with you. I pray that all of the junk that we were thinking about before we tuned into this message, all of the stuff that we were thinking about that has to be done, all of the details would just fade away, and it would be an incredibly clear moment of you and you alone. God, may your scripture be that powerful to us. May we weep because it is so incredibly emotional. May we be cut to the heart because it is so real. God, would you allow us to confess the sin that we've been holding on to? Would you allow us to truly die to ourselves and pick up our cross and follow you? God, that's the power of your scripture. That's the power of your Holy Spirit. And we want to experience that power this morning. So please, oh please, make this a holy time. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be pleasing in your sight. For you're my rock and you're my redeemer. In your holy name we pray. Amen. I want to look at especially 4 through 11, but even as I was writing that we wanted to look at chapter 1, verses 4 through 11, we can't even jump to verse 4 without first looking at verse 3, because it is such a really incredible start to this story, because it is such an incredible thing that has been happening for 40 days after Jesus was risen again. And if you heard the podcast this week, if you heard Gary and Jesse talk about stuff, we talked a lot about the number 40, and I won't go completely down that rabbit trail, but I encourage you to do some research on what does 40 have to do with Scripture, on what does 40 have to do with what Christ was trying to communicate, what does 40 have to do with being tied together with all of the Old Testament, with all of the New Testament that has happened, and with all of the things that they have to look forward to. 40 days after the resurrection. This is where the scene begins. This is where we start to see what Christ is going to communicate with his disciples. And I thought it was really important to have verse 3 especially, because if you read this on verse 3, after his suffering. And I wanted to just pause on that for just a second, and I wanted to reference a message that I think we saw together. If you were part of the Global Leadership Summit group, you saw Erwin McManus. If you read through that book, The Last Arrow, then you saw this understanding of how incredible it is to have something happen after the suffering. In fact, to quote him directly, he said something like this: your greatness is on the other side of your pain. And how true that is, that we can understand that in this moment, because you recognize how incredible it is to be where you are at. To be at the point where we at least see a little bit of a glimpse at the light at the end of the tunnel. To be at the point where maybe, just maybe, this virus thing isn't going to continue on forever. To be at the point where maybe, just maybe, your addiction is starting to go away. To see just a little bit of that glimpse and to know that your greatness is on the other side of that pain. And to know that because of all of the junk that we've been through in the last 6 months, that makes the light seem even more bright. We have to know how dark the dark is in order to understand how light the light is. We have to know that on the other side of the suffering, we have an incredible story to tell. A testimony is even more of a testimony when I can say I went through all of that junk and now I have the ability to say this is what God got me through. And this is the reality of what Jesus is feeling, of what he's saying, of what Luke is communicating to us in Acts. Recognize and remember that this is the resume. This is why Luke goes into all of the things of the early church. This is why everything is present. This is why it's possible to do this in this moment, because of the fact that Jesus suffered. If he didn't suffer, if this line wasn't here, if that suffering never happened, then what on earth are we praising him for? What on earth are we excited about? We can be excited because of the fact that he went through that suffering and there's more story. It doesn't end with the suffering. It doesn't end with the cross. It doesn't end with the grave. That's only the beginning. And how true is that? Maybe you need to hear that this morning through the power of the Holy Spirit. It doesn't end with your difficult time. That's just the beginning. That's just the beginning. And that's where the Holy Spirit can come in and change something around. That's where the Holy Spirit can do something incredible. I've been waiting all 6 months for you in the building to at least give me an amen or something. And I was getting really excited about after his suffering. So come on, you got to give me something, okay? Next time. There you go. I heard you online too. I think they said it. I think it was Sandra. after 40 days of the resurrection, after the suffering that Jesus went through, then the story begins. And so maybe, just maybe, you need to hear that this is where your story begins. The difficult time is not where your story ends, it's where it begins. After his suffering, he presented himself to the disciples, and he gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. How many different proofs have you seen in the last 6 months? I know you have. In fact, we were working on it with the prayer team about some possible way to just share a little glimpse of where you've seen God, where you've seen him work, even through the difficult time of the virus, even through the difficult time of job layoffs, of all of those bad things. You see glimpses, don't you? And I know that if you put the goggles on that say, I'm looking for them, then you're going to see these many convincing proofs that Jesus is alive. And I ask you and I challenge you through the power of the Holy Spirit, would you put those glasses on so that when you're going through a monotonous day, so that when you're going through a difficult time, you're able to pay attention to the many convincing proofs that Jesus is alive. In Acts chapter 1, he appeared to them over a period of 40 days. Again, the 40 days as a reference to so many things that tie it together, as a reference to all of those things that take place in the early church. 40 days, and he spoke to them about the kingdom of God. Now let's get into our actual sermon. Ready? Here we go. Acts chapter 1, verse 4. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command: do not leave Jerusalem, but instead wait for the gift my Father has promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. Just a couple of things that we have to point out here as we look at verses 4 and 5. I want you to pay attention to the eating. I've mentioned this before, and this is really a callback to communion. This is really a callback to that breaking of bread. This is really a callback to the vulnerability that he was having with them. There's something incredible about getting your legs under the table with someone, about being close to someone, about being vulnerable with someone, about sharing a meal with someone, because that's the exact same thing that he was doing. And I want you to pay attention to his guidelines as far as how he commutes with them, as far as how he communes with them, as far as how he is in relationship with them. He's vulnerable. He's close to them. He understands that as we sit together, as we eat together, as we dine together, that's where relationships are born. And I want to remind you of the fact that Living Water Community Church really just emphasizes relationships in order to be close to one another, in order to have the ability to share the gospel of Jesus Christ, in order to see that gospel do the life transformation. That's not our own strength. That's not a human nature thing. That's maybe even different from our human nature to be close to one another, to have a relationship with one another, so that I know you well enough in order to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. We emphasize relationships, not only as an organization, but my prayer is as individuals as well. We emphasize the fact that we want to have a relationship with each other. As Jesus is doing this, while he's eating with them, he gives them this command: don't leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift. Several times throughout this passage, you're going to see these words. You're going to see B-U-T. You're going to see but. And Jesus redirects them into a different thing than what they were originally thinking. And this is primary to this passage. This is something that I think the Holy Spirit is pointing out to me in particular, and maybe to you as well. How many times does he have to redirect me? How many times does he have to say, I know, you're thinking you need to go this way. You're thinking you need to do this. But there's something else that I have for you. And maybe that's the Holy Spirit speaking to you directly, saying, I know that you think you need to go this way. I know you need to accomplish this. I know you're thinking that you need to do this. But wait, I have something else. And how many times do we really weigh that in our heads and say, okay, but if he has something else, my plans were all over here. My plans were all doing this other thing. And I want to encourage you and I want to remind you that his plans are so much greater than yours. I want to remind you of the fact that as we think in human nature terms, his mind is so much bigger, his picture is so much bigger. He sees a grand vision that we cannot see. But wait, he says, wait for the gift my Father has promised. We're going to talk a little bit more about what that gift is, especially as you see verse 5 say, you're going to be baptized with the Holy Spirit, knowing that the baptism of the Holy Spirit is something that we cannot take lightly, knowing that after all of these years that we have passed since Pentecost, we still have the belief that the Holy Spirit is alive and active. A quick theology lesson means that we believe in a Trinitarian God. We believe in the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And we believe that each one of those persons is truly God. And somehow, beyond our imagination, three persons is one God. And somehow, beyond what we can understand, those three persons have specific roles, have specific jobs. God the Creator, God the Father, God the one who has set all things in order, Jesus Christ the Son, who spent his time on the cross so that we didn't have to. Jesus Christ, our Savior, who was risen from the grave in order to give us hope for a new life. And of course, the Holy Spirit, never lesser, never just the third person, the Holy Spirit, the presence of God in my very heart. That's why we can say what I said at the beginning of this service. That's why we can say God is here. That's why we can say he is present in this very moment, because of the Holy Spirit that is in this place, because of the Holy Spirit that is in you listening, because of the Holy Spirit that gives us the power that rose Jesus from the grave. One reference that I wanted to make was to Romans. Oh, excuse me. I'm not sure why I was going to go to John 15. There was something really important about John 15, and someday I'm going to tell you about it. Where is my passage? Romans 6, verse 4. There we go. Romans 6, verse 4 is what I wanted to reference with the power of the Holy Spirit. Recognizing that we have the same power living inside of us, recognizing that we have this ability that Christ said, you're going to do even greater things than I am doing. And part of the greater means that we are multiplied, right? One person cannot accomplish as much as a dozen people. A dozen people can't accomplish as much as 60 people. And 60 can't accomplish as much as 120. And it continues to be multiplied because of the fact that each of us has the ability to go and share that gospel of Jesus Christ, and to go and share the fact that the Holy Spirit is powerful. And in Romans, Paul is talking about this work of the Holy Spirit when he says, we were therefore buried with Jesus Christ through baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. Through the power of the Holy Spirit, we live that new life, which means we carry our cross, which means we share the gospel, which means we care about others more than I care about myself, which means I do all of the things that Christ did through the power of the Holy Spirit. So let's jump back then to Acts chapter 1, verse 6. Acts chapter 1, verse 6 says this. They gathered around him. The disciples were gathering around Jesus. Remember the scene that we have. Remember the fact that it was 40 days after the resurrection. Remember that he was eating with them. He was teaching them. He was fellowshipping with them. And so here they are in one specific place where Jesus is centered. And they gather around him and they ask him, Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel? How many teachers we have in the building? We have a couple. I know we do. We got one. Some of you are kind of like not very sure. Yeah, you're a teacher. Yep. Yeah. You're a teacher. How many? Oh, we got a lot of trainers. Like you train somebody in something. I know we got a few of those. How many of you people, as you teach, as you train, as you give a lesson, how many of you do this? Oh! Try being a pastor. You do it all the time. Laugh. Man, I need you people. Come on.
YouTube, laugh at least a little bit. You're doing this training. You're explaining something to someone. You're giving them an instruction. You're giving them a lesson. You're giving them what they need to learn. And they ask a question so far out of left-hand field that you have no idea what it has to do with anything. This is the exact moment. This is what I'm trying to portray. This is the analogy that Jesus had to examine as he's gathering them, as they're in this central location, as he's telling them, you're going to get the power of the Holy Spirit. Man, we're going to do some incredible things. This is going to spread like wildfire. The early church is going to begin, and they come up and say, are you going to restore the kingdom to Israel? No, 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 guys, you're missing the point. Come on, guys, this is not about an earthly kingdom. This is not about you having more power as your nation. This is not about just Israel receiving a kingdom. This is a bigger picture. This is something huge. This is something amazing. And you're going to sit and think about just Israel? Maybe, just maybe, the Holy Spirit is giving you this tap on the shoulder. What in the world are you needing to be redirected from? What are you focusing on that he's saying, that's such small potatoes. I don't want you to focus on that small thing. I want you to see the big picture. I want you to see the incredible thing that the power of the Holy Spirit is going to do. Don't pay attention to just a limited view of, are you going to restore the kingdom to Israel? No, no, no. Pay attention to the big thing that he is going to accomplish. His answer then, of course, come on, guys. It's not for you to know the times. It's not for you to know the dates the Father has set by his own authority. Again, we see this example of being redirected. So many times throughout his earthly ministry, we saw him do this with the Pharisees. We even saw him do this with his own disciples. He did it with Philip, if you remember, when he gave a huge example of what it means to live a new life. And Philip went the complete other direction. And Jesus said, do you not understand, Philip? Do you still not understand that I am in God and God is in me? And if you look at Jesus Christ, you see the Creator. Do you not understand that I am the way and the truth and the life, Philip? And he had to facepalm there. He had to say, come on, guys. I've given you this a dozen times. I've given you this same message over and over again about how needed Jesus Christ is, about how incredible the power is of the Holy Spirit. And this is the same message that he's saying. It's not for you to know those times. It's not for you to know the dates. It's not for you to know the end of this story. It's for you to know how this gets started. It's for you to play the role that I've asked you to play. It's for you to do the thing that God is counting on you to do. That's not your problem. Let me do the ending stuff. Let me know the dates and the times. Let me know about the full completion of the kingdom. And you do what I've asked you to do. And so what did he ask us to do? What did he command us to do? He redirects them again with the B-U-T, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the very ends of the earth. The redirection there is so important, and I don't want you to miss it. He's giving them another glimpse of what we call the Great Commission. He's giving them another glimpse of what he has commanded them to do in the first place. And rather than be redirected into restoring the kingdom of Israel, rather than to just talk about them having power as an Israelite nation, he's reminding them, no, you have a job to do that I've already commanded. You have a job that you as disciples are responsible for, to be my witnesses, to talk about Jesus, to talk about the way and the truth and the life, to talk about the living water of Jesus Christ. And I reference Matthew here, 28, verse 19. That's, of course, the Great Commission. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. Don't forget, this is your assignment. Don't forget, this is what the goal is. Don't forget, this is the role that he has asked you to play. Not to worry about the kingdom of Israel, not to worry about you as an individual, but to worry about spreading that name of Jesus Christ.
And what does that look like for you? That's where I rely on the Holy Spirit to tap you on the shoulder and to say, who is it that I need to share this gospel with? How is it that I need to live out this gospel? Because the Holy Spirit is empowering me to do it. The Holy Spirit is empowering me to do exactly this job, to do the work that He has asked me to do. And so again, as the disciples receive their assignment, as they get told to be His witnesses, they stand and they wait. They stand and they miss the point. They stand and they watch. And part of what I wanted to title this message, if we were going to go with titles, it was going to be something around the line of actively waiting. Because realistically, we talked about this in the podcast too, not only do we have 40 days mentioned so many times, not only do we see the redirection of the BUT, but do this instead, we also see the fact that so many different times Jesus tells them to wait. Wait for the power of the Holy Spirit. Wait in Jerusalem until the Holy Spirit comes. Wait for this, wait for that. And so if you really wanted to push this, you could actually say, well, hey, they are waiting. That's what He told them to do. As the angels come down and they see this group standing here, Jesus ascends in verse 10, and He goes back up to be with His Father, and they stand there and they watch, and the angels come in and they say, men of Galilee, why do you stand here looking into the sky? This same Jesus who has been taken from you into heaven is going to come back in the same way you have seen Him go into heaven. And so the language becomes, what are you doing? Why are you standing here? And if I was a disciple, if I was absolutely literal, I would say, He told me to wait right here. He told me to wait. He told me to stand here and wait for the gift that's going to come. But how is it then that in my simple mind, I can somehow not just passively wait, but actively wait? How is it that I can do the work that He has already told me to do while preparing myself for Him to come again? Again, we lean on the power of the Holy Spirit to know and to absolutely be certain that this is not about passively waiting. This is not about being a participant. This is not about being an observer. This is about being a participant. So many times we've had that discussion. I think it's been in several different sermons about listening to a sermon, about being someone who is just only observing, who is only sitting out in the crowd. And that's not what we ask you to do at Living Water. That's not what we ask you to do as disciples of Jesus Christ. I don't want more and more observers. We want more and more participators. We want people who are going to take this word and put it into action. We want people who are going to do what Jesus has already asked of us to do. We don't sit and passively wait. We don't just ask Him over and over again, what am I supposed to do? What am I supposed to do? What am I supposed to do? No, He has told us what to do. Teach, baptize. Be redirected from the junk that you thought as a human nature you were supposed to do, and pay attention to what it is that He is telling you to do. And so then the end of chapter 1. Oh, no, it's not. There you go. Oh, man, I'm jumping all over the place. They were looking. Suddenly two men dressed in white stood beside them. That's what we said. And, of course, at Living Water we seek to follow Jesus. I must have jumped over. Do you have verse 12, Matt? Or verse 11, what's the ending that you have? Jesus is taken up. This is the ending of our chapter anyways. This is what gets us set up for Pentecost. This is what prepares us for the Holy Spirit being given to the disciples. I think what I wanted to reference was the fact that this is the ending of a season for those disciples. And really, remember, throughout history of the Old Testament, we hear the fact that there are seasons to everything. We hear of the fact that there's a season to weep, there's a season to rejoice, there's a season to reap, there's a season to sow. And all of these things remind us that the reality of this world is that everything happens in seasons. And I want to emphasize that. I keep saying that to myself. I keep saying that to Sandra as we try to go through this time. Maybe just a little bit of an uplifting kind of thing. This too shall pass. this season isn't forever. This season of distancing, this season of quarantining, this season of virusing, this season of all of these things that have to change our patterns will not last forever, which means the season of Jesus being with them was ending. And that's hard, and that's difficult, and that's sad. And if you're one of those disciples, you're actually thinking back to when he said, it's good for you that I go away, and you're saying, really? Really, how can that possibly be that it's good for me that you leave? And that references back to the Trinitarian theology. That references back to what Jesus told those disciples time and time again. You are going to have the power to do the incredible things that I have done and to do even greater things than these. Don't waste the power. Why stand there looking? He is coming back. Why stand there looking when you have a job to do? Why stand there passively waiting when he has already told you how to actively wait? In the power of the Holy Spirit, we do that. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen. Let's pray together. God, somehow, some way, speak to us in a way that we understand. Somehow, some way, use any broken words that I have and get your message across. Give us reason to have joy. Give us reason to praise. Give us reason to be challenged. Give us some possible way to see you even more clearly this morning. God, we know that this has been a rough time. We know that jobs have been lost. We know that viruses have been spread. We know that health has been at risk. And we know that somehow, some way, after the suffering comes a possibility of seeing you even brighter, a possibility of seeing you in a way we didn't see before. God, we know that your challenge still exists. We know that your job that you have given us is still applicable. Go into all the nations and be witnesses. That means that I act differently as a witness of Jesus Christ. I speak differently as a witness of Jesus Christ. I use the time of waiting differently. And I can only do this through the power of your Holy Spirit. I can only do this when you come upon so incredibly strong that they can't tell where I end and where you begin. So God, for me, for all of us, send your Holy Spirit among us. We pray that we would receive your power, that we would receive your strength, that we would receive your comfort. God, you've already done it. You've fulfilled your promise. You've sent the Holy Spirit. And so again, remind us. Remind us of how true you are. Remind us of how real you are. Remind us of what you have done, of what you are doing, and of what you will do. In your holy, holy, holy name, we pray. Amen.
So let's stand wherever you're at, whether you're here in this room, or you're online. Let's worship our King, who's kept every promise, who suffered and died and rose again.
There was a moment when the sky lights went out, when death had claimed its victory. The King of love had given up his life. The darkest day of history. There on a cross that made for sinners, for every curse his blood atoned. breath and it was finished. But not the end we could have known. For the earth began to shake. Was made as the heavens roar. All hail King Jesus. All hail the Lord of heaven and earth. There was a moment when the sky lit up, a flash of light breaking through. When all was lost, he crossed eternity. The King of life was on.
We give him honor. We give him glory. We hail the King Jesus. And how do we respond? What is a tangible way that we give of ourselves? He asks us to give an offering, to give a tithe, to give what he has already blessed us with. We We have several ways that you can do that during this time. We have our offering set up on forallwhothirst.com. Over on the right-hand side of that webpage, you can find the online giving section. You can also text 84321, enter your desired amount and text that number. You can also mail your offering in to P.O. Box 197 in Orange City, Iowa. For those of you gathered here, we have baskets on the way out so that you can drop your offering in without making any contact, without doing anything that spreads that virus. Of course, you can drop that on your way out. During this next song, we do this prayerfully, we do this worshipfully, we give of ourselves in a way that He asks us to give. During this next song, we'll take our offering.
Yeah, so this next song might be a little bit new for some of you guys. If you don't know it, it's pretty easy to catch on to. It's got a really simple melody, and the words of it are so beautiful. And in the last verse, it just reminds me of the promise that we see in Revelation. Revelation 21 and 22 talks about the holy city that the Lord brings down to earth and meets with His people. And it says that no longer will there need to be any sun or moon, because the Lord will be the light, and He will be with His people, and He will wipe every tear from their eyes. So in this time that we're experiencing, where everything's not perfect, we're here, but we're not all together yet. Let's cling to the promises of God.
Restored is done.
Amen. Though we are bruised, we are not beaten. Though we are pushed down, we are not defeated. As Paul says, we are more than conquerors through him, through his Jesus Christ. Because of the power of the Holy Spirit, we can accomplish these things. Because of the power of the Holy Spirit, we can be the witnesses to Judea, to Samaria, to all the ends of the earth. That's what he's asking us to do, to be his witnesses, to be a positive influence when there is so much darkness. Go and do that positive influence. A few housekeeping things. We have met here on campus. For those of you streaming YouTube, we have gone just YouTube. We are going to continue to see what works, what doesn't work. We're going to continue to weigh the options of what this looks like as we meet together. I welcome your comments, your concerns, your questions, all of those things. You see my email on so many different places. Shoot me a message, and we will do our best to stay safe, to stay secure, to stay worshipful. A few housekeeping things for just those of you here. Stay in your spot until the usher tells you to exit. We're going to exit through this big garage door so that there's no interaction, so that there's no spreading of the viruses. So stay where you're at until you're told to exit. And for all of us, stay connected through the power of the Holy Spirit. Pay attention to your email. Pay attention to your Facebook page. Pay attention to the YouTube channel. All of these ways are ways that we stay connected, that we stay one as a body of Jesus Christ. With all of that being said, take this blessing with you as you go. May the God of all grace, after you have suffered a little while, himself restore you and make you strong and firm and steadfast. And unto him, be the glory and the power forever and ever. Amen. Go in peace.